Morning, Mount Airy Wesleyan. So good to have you guys join us. We're going to jump right in. Me and Don were talking about the extra freedom that you guys have to worship at home. We want you guys, this next song, to turn your volume up almost as much as you can handle it. So we turned it up extra loud here this morning. So it is booming. So join us together in worship.
Joining us.
thanks for coming. Make sure to share, like the page. That way we can have more people involved. So here we go, what mercy did for me.
Touching base with you throughout the week, and coming up with a new plan. All right. Sunday school, if you're interested, we are posting a Sunday school with Dr. Bob Black, Sunday mornings at 10. That'll be on our Facebook page. And don't forget, for giving, tithes and offerings, we've got the drop box outside the fellowship hall, closest to Pastor Eric's office. You can give on Givelify. Again, that's the easiest way. Or you can just mail it into the church. Also, to keep up with what's going on, to see devotionals and that sort of thing, there's lots and lots of stuff being put out on the church's Facebook page. And also, we have the One Call system, and so things are being sent out from that, prayer requests and all kind of things. So if you're not on the One Call and you want to receive those calls, just let somebody here at the church know, and we'll put your number in, and you'll start receiving those calls. All right? So, again, welcome here. As we go through the service, even once the preaching starts, I'm still going to be on the Facebook Live. So shoot me a comment, and I'll send something back to you, and we'll just engage the best way that we can. All right? Let's continue to worship. I know you're still at home. You're in your pajamas. Stand up. All right.
This next song is a beautiful and very appropriate song for the season. God of All My Days.
Thank you.
In my bondage, God, you are my freedom. Oh, my grace. So we have Psalm 28 here that I was reading over, and it's labeled as my strength. So I want to sort of read through that and just pray. So I want you guys to either pull Psalms 28 out or just close your eyes and listen. Pray along with us. So it says, Lord, my rock, I call out for you for help. Lord, do not be deaf to me. If you're silent, I would be like those in the grave. But hear our prayer. Hear the sound of our prayer when we cry out to you for help. God, we are crying out for your help this morning. We raise our hands towards you to your most holy place, Father. Don't drag us away with the wicked or those who do evil, for they say peace to their neighbors, but evil is in their heart. So pay them back for what they've done, for they have done evil. Pay them back for what they have done, Lord. But give them their reward, for they don't understand what the Lord has done or what he has made. So he will knock them down and not lift them up. But praise the Lord, he heard our prayer this morning for help. God, you are our strength and our shield. We trust you, Father. And he helps us. He helps me. He helps us here. He helps you at home this morning. For we should be very happy that we have your attention, Father. And we praise you with our song this morning that we lift collectively in our community. The Lord is powerful. You are powerful. And he gives, and you give us power and victory, for you have chosen us, Father. Oh, Lord, we pray deeply that you save your people. Blessed are those who are your own. Thank you, God, that we can call you Father and that you are our own. Be our shepherd. Carry us forever. In your name we pray. Amen. So we know you know this song. Because it lives in the fabric of this society right now, we want to join together. Sing with all of our hearts. For you make life worth living no matter the circumstance. God sent his son. Sing it. They call him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He bled and died to because he lives. Because he lives. because he lives.
People, and I want us to understand that only God can fix it.
Only God can. We can, but only God can. We have the potter. We have the wheel. We have the clay. But what in the world do all of these symbolize? The first thing is this: the shaping of a person. The shaping of a person. Verse 3 of Jeremiah 18, it says, "So I went down to the potter's house, and I saw him working on the at the wheel." We don't have to wonder who the potter is, because in verse 6 it says, "He said, can I do nothing with you, Israel, as the potter does?" Declares who? Declares the Lord. "Like clay in my hand, in the hand of the potter, so are you in the hands, and so you are in my hand, Israel." God being our potter, he makes us, he shapes us, he breaks us into the people that he desires for us to be. God is the master potter, and I want us to understand that God has a great purpose, and he has a great plan for your life. Listen, he made every life, and he didn't make you by accident. You are not a mistake, but God made you on purpose. Psalm 139, 13 through 14, it says, "For you formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made." Some of y'all really need to claim that verse in the name of Jesus this morning. So maybe look at your brother, your sister that doubt that you were fearfully and wonderfully made. Maybe it's a good time to look at them and say, "I am fearfully and wonderfully made." Go ahead to them. Whoever's sitting beside you this morning, laying in bed, whatever it may be, "I am fearfully and wonderfully made." You are fearfully and wonderfully made. And don't let Satan lie to you to make you believe that you are not fearfully and wonderfully made. And I love how the psalmist closes this: "Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well." I know it. I claim it. I say that I am fearfully and wonderfully made. The handprint of God is on every life. And his desire is to make you a beautiful vessel, not for your honor and not for your glory, but for his honor and for his glory. You are beautiful and you are valuable to God. You are not a result of chaos and confusion. You are not a result of random choice, or as the abortionists would say, the product of conception. You are not here by fate or accident. Evolutionists say that we are here by a series of accidents. They say there's no real logic or real design. You just happen. I feel sorry for these people, because there's no hope. There's no hope of a savior, and there is no hope of eternal life. But in Genesis 1:1, it says, "In the beginning was" who? God. And in the beginning, God what? He created. You and I were made by God himself. Oh, friend, that's where hope begins. Realizing that God is real and that we are not an accident. And God made us on purpose. And he made us for a mission. And he made us for a plan. You were made. You were created. You were crafted in your mother's womb. And you were made in the image of Almighty God. God breathed life into mankind. Why would I say this? Job 33:4, it says, "The Spirit of God has made me, and the breath of Almighty God gives me life." I love what St. Augustine said. He said this: "You made us for yourself, O Lord, and our heart is restless until it rests in you." Isn't this a perfect quote for where we're at today? Let me say it again. "You have made us for yourself, O Lord, and our heart is restless until it rests in you." We will never find hope in chasing the things of the world, chasing a career, chasing all the things that the world has to offer, all the possessions that the world has to offer. And listen, you will never find true happiness in doing so. We only find it when we know who our Maker is. And whenever we surrender our lives fully and completely to him, then we find complete peace. Then we find comfort. Then we find true happiness. Then we truly find a blessed life, and we truly find joy in our lives. Psalm 16:11 says, "You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of" what? of joy, in your presence, fullness of joy, as we desire him, as we live with him, as we commune day to day with him. At your right hand are pleasures forever. We know what true joy is. Whenever we place our life, our fears, our burdens, the entirety of who we are, in the hands of the master potter. So what does the clay represent? We are the clay. We are the clay. How does that make you feel whenever I say, you're nothing but a piece of dirt? Are you nothing but a piece of clay? A piece of dust? Isn't it awful whenever I say this? It makes you feel all bubbly, like you matter, like there's value to your life, right? Man, I'm just a piece of clay. I remember when me and my brothers, whenever we grew up in West Virginia, Beckley, West Virginia, and we would play down in kind of a valley and a wooded area, and we made tree houses all the times and clubhouses all the times. Of course, we'd have to tear them down whenever the neighbors would call dad and say, can you have your kids tear down this god-awful thing that they built behind my house? But anyway, we would dig, and we would dig holes, and we would put posts in it. And it was so annoying whenever we would hit this worthless, ugly, no-good clay. It was an ugly color. It was a bright brown, if I may. It was just awful. There was nothing good about clay. In fact, if there's clay in your flower bed, you do away with it, because we know hardly anything can vegetate whenever it is in clay. But when the potter, think about this, but when the potter gets a hold of the clay and he begins to work it, he makes something beautiful of it. Your life, just a clump of clay, that's all it is. And whenever we put our lives in the hands of the potter, the master potter, he takes this no good clay that is worthless, and he shapes it, and he crafts it, and he works it into something beautiful. Genesis 2:7, it says, then the Lord God formed the man from the dust of the earth, the ground. Ecclesiastes 3:20, it says, all go to the same place, all came from the dust, and all return to the dust. A little boy went to a Sunday school class, and he heard this particular verse in Ecclesiastes 3:20, and he asked his mom, and he said, is this true, that we were formed from the dust, and that we will return to the dust? And the mom said, yes, that's exactly right, son. And the little boy turned to his mom and said, you'd better go look under my bed then, because there's either somebody coming or somebody going. I thought that was cute. Thank you for laughing at the pastor's joke. We are just, we're just clay. I looked up on my phone and actually heard somebody say this week, and I looked it up on my phone. Do you realize that a human body isn't worth much? If you look it up on your phone, go ahead and say, hey, Google, how much is a human body worth? Or ask on Siri or Google, whoever it is, how much is a human body worth? And it will tell you that a human body, as you read the articles, is only worth $3 to $10. Boy, that'll make you feel valuable, right? That's it. Only $3 to $10. That's all it's worth. But I want you to understand, to God, you're worth everything. To God, you are worth everything. Why would I say this? Because in Romans 5:8 it says, but God shows his love for us, and while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. God sees so much value in you, and he gave everything that he had, everything that was important to him, his son, to die on a cross for the remission of sin. This is why we do not put hope in the things of the world, but this is why we put our hope in Jesus Christ. Mark 8:36 says, what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world, but yet loses or forfeits his own soul? The things of this world truly is invaluable in the light of eternity. What really matters is that you have a relationship with Jesus Christ. That's what really matters. The third thing is this, the wheel. What in the world does the wheel represent? The wheel is the daily turns and twists of life.
It's the daily turns and twists of life. Do you ever feel like that your life is on the wheel and it's just going round and round and round? And some of y'all getting motion sickness thinking about just going round and round and round. Or how about this? Your life is on the wheel and it's just getting crazier and crazier and crazier. Or maybe it's on the wheel and it never slows down and it's just going faster and faster. Or maybe for you, it's getting bumpier or bumpier. It's like a roller coaster. And it's up and down and up and down. The wheel represents the turns and the twist of life. If you would have told me in January that the church would be meeting online, I would have told you that you were crazy, or maybe would have even said you're dumb. I don't know. But I would have probably said you're nuts, maybe, perhaps. But for all of us, the wheel has slowed down, hasn't it? I can say that. Because I truly believe that God has slowed down the wheel on purpose. And I believe that He has slowed down our lives because we've become so intrigued with the world. And we've become so enveloped in the world. And our eyes and our ears and our heart and our mind are so focused on the wheel. And I truly believe He's saying right now, be still and know that I am God. It's time to slow down. And I believe that God has brought us to this point. Hey, I believe that He brought me to this point a while back ago. I thought I had the flu and I was quarantined because of the flu for a couple days. I thought I was going to die. It was actually absolutely terrible. And in my mind, God was trying to tell me, slow down. And then I broke my arm. And I believe God was trying to tell me, Eric, you need to slow down. Concentrate on what really matters, on what's really important. And now we're quarantined to our homes. And I believe He's saying to me, and He's saying to you, listen, it's time to slow down. It's time to concentrate on me and the plans that I have for you and the hope that is truly only found in me. Ephesians 2:10, it says, for we are God's masterpiece. We are His workmanship. We are His piece of art. And He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so that we can do good things that He planned for us to do a long time ago. Maybe He's trying to tell us your job, your career, in the grand scheme of things, isn't really what matters most. Maybe you lost touch with God and He's trying to speak to your heart even so right now. And maybe for some of us, He's saying it's time to learn to trust me. It's time to truly to learn to have faith in me. Maybe for some of us, He's slowing us down on the wheel. And maybe for some of us, He's saying your priorities are all messed up. And He's saying maybe it's time to put me back at the center of it all, at the center of your life, at the core of your life. Maybe for some of you watching, maybe you're realizing the importance of your family. I'll have to be honest with you. I'm a workaholic and God has slowed me down so I can realize how important my wife is. And for the last week, she has been more beautiful, more gorgeous, more lovely, and I have seen more happiness in my life. I've spent so much time with her. Maybe God's trying to show you how important church is. For so many of us, we miss it. And I get your text. I'm texting you and I'm making phone calls to our seniors and to our shut-ins. So many people are like, man, I miss church. But maybe God's trying to tell us, do you realize how important it is that you meet together? He's trying to show us how important church is. And maybe for some of you, as the wheel has slowed down, maybe for some of you, you're thinking, man, whenever we get out of this quarantine, I need to get back in church. I need to become more involved in church. I need to connect better with a body of believers. I need to be baptized. I need to be saved. I need to be filled with the Holy Spirit so He can have full control of my life. There are so many things. And I believe God is saying, be still and know that I'm God. And God has to tell me all the time, shut up, Eric. It's time for me to speak. If you know me, I love to talk. And I love to talk to God. But sometimes God's trying to say, be still, Eric, and just listen. I believe that God is shouting to me. I believe that God is shouting to you. And I believe within my heart that God is shouting to this nation. And I believe that we are the people of God. And I believe that this scripture that we've quoted so many times is real to us today. If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray, and will seek my face, and will turn from their wicked or evil way, then will I hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. Listen, God is speaking to us during this time of quarantine. My question for you is this: what is he saying to you? He's trying to talk to you. He's trying to say something during this time. And he slowed down the wheel and the craziness of life to put you in the spot where you're at. And he wants to use it for his good. And he's saying, will you listen to me? A lot of people say that I believe that the church is going to come out of this, and the church is going to be weak, and the church is not going to survive, and the church is not going to be strong coming out of this thing. But I totally believe within my heart, as we seek Almighty God, as we humble ourselves, as we pray, as we repent, I believe that a revival and a great awakening is going to come out of this. I believe it with all of my heart. I believe we're going to see people saved. I believe we're going to see people baptized. And I believe it's going to happen because he's going to work through people like you and me that are truly devoted followers of Jesus Christ. Will you let him work through you? Will you let him work in you? Will you allow him to speak to you? A lot of people have said, man, I can't wait for the norm to come back. I'm just ready to go back to the norm. Can I be honest with you and tell you this? I hope we never go back to the norm in our lives. I hope we never go back to the norm in our lives. But I hope spiritually, that we will be so on fire for God, and we will spend so much time with God, and that we'll be devoted to him so much and seek after him so much that he will put a fire in our very being and inside of our bones, and that we will not be able to shut up about who God is, and that we will begin to express who God is to other people and give hope to the lost and dying world in which we live. This is what I truly believe with all my heart, but we have to listen. I believe God is going to work this for his good. Romans 8:28, and it says, and we know that God causes everything to work together for good of those who love God or the Lord and are called according to his purpose for them. So what about the marred clay? What about the spoil? I mean, what does this represent? Number four, the spoiling of a person's life. It's a life. The spoiling is the cracks. It's the clumps of clay on the side that aren't supposed to be there. It's the unevenness of the shape. It's the fact it's marred and it's cracked and it's crumbling and it's just not doing exactly what I want it to do. In Jeremiah 18:4, it says, and the vessel that he was making from the clay was spoiled in the hand of the potter. Listen, so he made it over, and I love to ask again. He made it over again, and I'm so thankful that he's made it over again and again and again for our lives. So he made it over again, reworking it into another vessel as it seemed good to the potter to make. I'm so thankful that his grace is so sufficient for you and for me, and his mercies are new every day. And maybe for you, maybe you're looking at your life and you see this masterpiece that God's trying to create. And you look in the mirror and you see the cracks and the blemishes and you see how it's spoiled and how it's marred, and you see your life. Here's the thing. God wants to take your brokenness and make you new. God wants to take your brokenness and reshape you and renew you so that you can become what it is that he desires for you to be. He wants to work through his grace and through his mercy and through his loving kindness to create you what it is that he's created you to be. I love what Rick Warren says. He says, God can take the mess in your life and bring a message out of you. Isn't that good? Or how about this? He said, he can take the test in your life and create a testimony out of it. Or how about this? He can take a crisis and show Christ through it. This is what he wants to do in your life. You're marred. You're spoiled. You're cracked. The shape is off kilter. Your life, you can tell it hasn't gone like God desires. You're on the wheel and it's just totally out of whack. And you haven't allowed the master potter to shape you like he desires to shape you. I want to encourage you this morning, or whenever you're watching this video, James 4:7, it says, submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Put your hand in the life of the potter. The potter wants to do an amazing thing in your life. And during this thing of quarantine, he wants to speak to you. He wants to work in your life. He wants to give you hope. But there's no way that we can have true 100% lasting hope until we allow our lives to be placed on the wheel and allow God to begin to take our worthless lives, this lump of clay that he considers valuable. And as he turns it, he says, I want to make something beautiful of your life. If you submit yourself to God, if you allow him to be the master potter, there will be a hope that is everlasting in your life. I love an old hymn, and the lyrics go like this: have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Thou art the potter, and I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will, while I am weighted, yielded, and still. We're stopped in life, we've slowed down. We're sitting around the house more than probably we ever had. And in the stillness and the calmness, I pray that you allow God to work in your life. About a year ago, actually it was exactly a year ago, I started a series, and some of y'all may remember it. It was called Five Challenging Prayers. Five Challenging Prayers. And it was taken out of Psalm 139, 23 through 24. And I want to encourage you to pray this every single day from your home. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there's any evil or wicked way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting. Here were the 5 points, and in fact, this was on a card that we gave to you, and in fact, if you scroll down underneath the Facebook Live, you will actually see on our Facebook page that there is a picture right there. There's a photo of the five challenging prayers, and I want you to save this on your desktop, save it on your phone, save it on your iPad, your tablet, whatever it may be. If you have the ability to print it off, I want to encourage you to print it off. And here are the 5 prayers that I believe we as a church and a society need to pray right now. We need to pray this again as a church. As you're fasting, as you're praying, we need to pray this. Lord, search me. Lord, break me. Lord, stretch me. Lord, lead me. And Lord, use me. Lord, search me, break me, stretch me, lead me, use me. I feel like that this is so important that we're going to send out these cards in the mail to our congregation again this week. And we're going to do a mailing, and we're going to send it out to you. And I want you to take this and post it up somewhere where you can see it every day. Lord, while I'm in quarantine and I'm being still and I'm listening to you, I am just this lump of clay. I'm just this broken pot. I'm just this worthless piece of dirt in your hands, and I pray that you would search me and break me and stretch me and lead me and use me. Right now, I ask that you would do that. Your brokenness, your hurts, your mistakes, your pains, your hang-ups, your losses, your failures are not final when you place your life in the hands of the potter, in the hands of the master potter. That is where we find hope. Wherever you're at, if you would bow your heads and you would close your eyes with me this morning. I believe that God is speaking to our hearts and God has slowed us down. He's quieted our lives. He's made a step back from it all. And he's saying to me, and he's saying to you this morning, will you place your life in my hands? Will you allow me to mold you and shape you and fashion you and create you? Design you and work on you so that you can be exactly what it is that he created you to be. So God, right now in this time of quarantine, it's so depressing for some. But Lord, this morning I ask as we focus on who you are, God, as we turn our lives back over to you, as we repent, as we humble ourselves. God, we place our life in your hand. And Lord, as you have, as we are still and as we are quiet, God, I ask that you would speak to our hearts in a mighty and powerful way. Lord, let us not turn deaf ear to your word and to your message. But Lord, wherever we are, and maybe we just need to kneel down at our bed, or kneel down at the sofa, or kneel down at the kitchen table, the dining room chair, wherever it may be, and say, God, I'm calling out to you. And Lord, I'm still. And I ask that you would lead me, that you would search me, that you would break me, that you would stretch me, that you would use me, oh God. Would you do it, Lord? Do it in me. Do it in the hearts and the lives of the members at our church. And oh Lord, we ask that you would do it in the world. Speak to our hearts, we pray. Amen.
You are
can pray for you. We just want you to know that we love you. If you would do us a huge favor, who's ever Facebook a page you're watching this, either Airy Wesleyan, Matter's group, business page, or a friend's page, please like and share the sermon and the worship. We believe that people need to be encouraged today, and we believe that the worship that we've experienced today and the lyric of the song and the instruments that are played for his honor, for his glory, and for the message, people need to hear this. So please like and share it. May God bless you. Thank you so much for joining.